Gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. It's Thursday evening. We're on Access Sacramento on Comcast Cable Channel 17 and also on www.youtube.com/user/LPSacto/videos. We're on Davis Cable Channel 15 and on the Roseville Community Television Comcast Channel 18. And welcome to this evening. I have some very wonderful guests here, outstanding young gentlemen in the field. We have Keaton here to my left, and I've got Vaughn to my right, and Ken here to my right. And please introduce yourselves, gentlemen. And my name's Steve Wood with Placer County LP. And welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve. My name's Ken Gillespie. I'm 24 years old. I've been a libertarian for a little over 5 years now. I'm the vice chairman of the Placer County Libertarian Party, with Steve being the chair. I also serve on the executive committee for the Libertarian Party of California.
I'm Vaughn. I've been a libertarian for about a year. Just met these guys recently, started going to some meetings.
It's just new to you, isn't it?
I wanted to spread the word of liberty. I'm glad to have met you guys, and thank you for inviting me to this show.
Oh, you're welcome.
I'm glad to be a visitor on the Libertarian Counterpoint.
Okay.
Hi, my name's Keaton. I've been a libertarian for about a year. I was introduced to Austrian economics with my economics teacher, and I've been a libertarian ever since.
Very good. Austrian economics.
Yeah.
That's a good way to start this segment, I think.
Yeah.
Yes, with... Come to think of it, 1913, come December 23rd, will be the 100th year of the Federal Reserve. That should be an anniversary we should celebrate, right?
I don't know about that.
Maybe not, huh?
Yeah.
We understand that the dollar in 1913 compared to today is probably about 5 cents on the dollar. It's been devalued tremendously, unfortunately, in our empire of debt here. And unfortunately, you younger people and this generation are the ones that are going to be bearing the brunt of that. I don't have a good reason why we're the most powerful nation on earth, and yet we have this deficit that's hanging over your generation and the next generation's heads. And it's unfortunate. I don't see that turning around, but with you young gentlemen here, maybe we'll get something turned around, because it needs to happen. It kind of maybe in a segue to what Vaughn was talking about earlier about taxes, and especially taxes in California. And I think Ken probably sensitive to that. Keaton probably sensitive to that with school. And, you know, it used to be, one parent worked and the other parent decided if he or she wanted to or not to, or wasn't so inclined, that was fine, and you could raise children. And all of a sudden, it went to two parents having to work full time, and then all of a sudden, the debt seemed, instead of earning and saving and buying homes and things, that now it's kind of a credit. It seems like the whole economic system has turned around. We're into this.
Yeah, that's
Keynes. Was it?
That's definitely true. I think that the cost of living has risen tremendously, and I think that a large part of that is due to inflation. Another part is direct taxes, and then there are other things that are a little bit more sneaky, like subsidies. That it's difficult to understand exactly how that affects us. I recommend there's a lot of good economics videos out there on the internet that will explain exactly how that affects our lives and increases our cost of living. If you see just over the past 10 years, the cost of food especially has gone up a lot. Oh, yeah. And you notice a lot of people can't eat out as much as they used to. I think that a lot of people simply aren't economically literate enough to understand what's going on. And I think the Federal Reserve is running this country into the ground, and it's making it harder and harder for us to earn our living. And some people have to turn to a second job, or they have to refinance their house, or go into debt in numerous ways. So And it used to be that, prior to the creation of the Federal Reserve, anyone could come here and work and earn enough money that they'd be able to sell down and have a decent house and be able to start a family. You know, it's the classic American dream, but it seems to, unfortunately, not to be that way anymore. I think that, if we turn more to a free as kind of society where, the money was based on something solid, something tangible like gold or another fixed in amount of money, mm-hmm. that we could have an economy that's based in real terms, a free market economy that could allow everyone to earn more than enough that they would need to survive. It would instead of one person taking more of the pie for themselves, it would grow the pie for everyone.
Yeah, you're talking about economic freedom as well as personal freedom mm-hmm. on the libertarian philosophies, and that Ludwig von Mises and Milton Friedman and many others, even back to Adam Smith, preached and taught us about. And we did quite well. We really did flourish. And it just seems like this last decade or so, it's been very difficult, and especially for this generation, for you guys. I mean, it seems like it's going to be a really tough road. I think you can do it. I don't think it's overwhelming, but it's not going to be easy.
Right. Yeah. Well, I think the mentality over the last 10 years has completely shifted from an idea of saving is the way to prepare for retirement is borrowing. Borrowing has become, besides just smoothing consumption for big purchases like a house and a car, it's almost been household in every single thing that you do nowadays. And that just goes along with the Federal Reserve and inflation that's going on, and especially Wall Street. Not just stocks, but mutual funds and the derivative market that we've had lately. Just how much we're leveraging kind of trickles down the ideology to household people of they're doing it, why shouldn't we? Mm-hmm. If they're getting success from it, obviously we may get success from it in this current market. Mm-hmm. People that actually do work hard and save their money aren't getting the benefits if they would ever otherwise just leverage themselves enough and maybe get more money from their returns.
What do you think, Vaughn?
Well, lately I've been noticing people will be more willing to take handouts. For instance, why aren't you doing this? I mean, everybody's doing it. That seems to be the mental status quo of what's going on right now.
Mm-hmm. It's hard to say no to free money, right?
Yeah. Why aren't you doing it?
We have, something like 50 million Americans now on some type of subsidy. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
And then we've got disability as well. And, I mean, we're here in the great state of California. And by the way, no updates on the Kings yet. I know everyone's still interested on the status there. But no, we don't know about the move yet. But I mean, there's a lot of things we take for granted here. But on the other hand, we do have some serious challenges in front of us. What else can we expand on a little bit?
Well, today CISPA, I know it passed through the House already, mm-hmm. which CISPA is something that the FBI and the military complex have interactions with each other. They don't need a warrant, and they can access any electronic device that they want to search for any form of terrorism or just to get background data that they can sell to companies. It's already what cell phone companies have been doing with your old text data and something. It's just expanded to every single medium.
Yeah. Well,
it's funny. I have a peer blocker on my computer where it blocks other IP addresses from getting into your system. And I look at some of those IP addresses, and a lot of them are companies that are like trying to AdSense, like trying to find out what ads to throw at me.
And no kidding.
It's crazy how much we're getting spied on
the third
right now
parties,
before CISPA.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, now that we have CISPA, the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act, not really for our protection, it's more for their protection. They want to know everything about us, and they won't need a warrant. They won't even need to go to a judge of any kind. They'll simply be able to see what you're talking about to your friends. The most intimate details of your life that you have on the internet are going to be open for anyone that the government wants to give it to. Yeah. And so the SOPA and PIPA, you know, last year in 2012, it was a big deal. A lot of people recognized that there it was a danger to our freedoms and our privacy. And it's terrible that, unfortunately, with these bombings in Boston, a lot of people were focused on that and the terrible tragedy of that. Well, quietly, Congress and the House of Representatives passed CISPA. I think that's just it's very backhanded and almost, you know, a double cross of the American people. I think that it's mm-hmm. becoming clear that they don't have our best interests at heart.
Yes, we had starting with the Unpatriot Act, and it seems like it's just kind of snowballed, and now it's a corporate. I guess corporate and government now kind of hand in hand and sharing information right. On everybody, on all individuals.
Yeah, George Orwell, you know, it was definitely foreshadowing something in his book 1984. You know, we definitely have Big Brother here today. It may not be as obvious as it is in the book 1984, but it's definitely out there. You know, the security cameras, everything, you know, it's become clear with the recent events and current events that anything that you do in the public eye can be found out. That you really don't have very much privacy anymore, and that's unfortunate. It's a change has been a big change in the past 15 years or so.
I think I've recently heard a story. A father, he owns guns with his kid, and he had a AR-15 his kid was holding in a picture. And this is in New Jersey, and they have some kind of hotline where somebody can call in. There might be a problem, and cops wanted to search his house, tear apart his guns, make sure everything's registered, even though there's no long gun registry in New Jersey. But they wanted to go into the house, tear apart everything, just because his kid was holding an AR-15 in a picture that his dad lets him shoot and mm-hmm. has fun with.
Wow.
And didn't break the law, but they were just trying to convince him to get in that house until he, you know, he called a gun rights lawyer and ended up stopping them in their tracks. But
yeah, that costs money, though, doesn't it?
It's terrible how the government seems to harass anyone that steps out of line at all. I know I was 12 when I got my first gun, and my dad gave it to me, and he took me to a range and taught me how to shoot. You know, I think that that's frowned upon by many of the people in the establishment and the people in government, and they don't want people to be self-sufficient. They want people to be dependent mm-hmm. on them. I think that you see that a lot with the increase in people taking handouts, such as food stamps and that sort of thing. Not necessarily that it's their fault, but you know, it's the government's fault for handing out this money and making people dependent on them. It's a form of enslavement, and I think it's very tricky for people to understand that. Of course, we want to help people that are in need, but I think that the free market and private charities can take care of that. Yeah. People can help people far better than the government can. The government simply wants the power.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. I was just watching a really, really old video about when they were going to enact welfare and just the idea between private charities and the welfare system, and it's the same exact argument, just escalated to a new level. Ever since 1980, we got rid of economic history in the curriculum in K-12 schools. And I think that's just skyrocketed economic illiteracy towards welfare systems and the huge burden they have on society. I think if we were actually understanding of what was going on out there and how the system interworked, because government always takes a little bit off the top of that to begin with. And we have the majority of the welfare cases here in California, just in California alone. I just think being more literate, it's not completely the government's fault, but if we just understood it a little bit more and were more aware, I don't think this problem would be as big as it is today.
Do they want transparency? I don't know.
I don't know about that one.
Well, speaking on that, with the socialized health care, with Obamacare, there's certain companies, I can get into how much damage it's done and how much damage it will do. But, I mean, just talking to several fellow employees, like, we're limited to 28 hours per week. That's a little cushion to the 30 hours because the company doesn't want to pay for all those benefits. They would be forced to pay all these health benefits if an employee went over 30 hours. And I just recently got done talking with a coworker. He's like, I don't know how I can live off this.
Wow.
Another coworker saying, I don't know how I'm going to get my next car payment. I think if when we try to equal out everybody, try to, you know, equal it out, it's the society is going to decay, in my opinion.
Yeah, it's unfortunate, but there's a lot of regulations that are in place that that make it very difficult for businesses to you know help out their employees as much as they might like to, and you know people think that these regulations are here to help, but in reality they hurt us. They hurt especially small business owners. And I think that's why you see so many big corporations, because they are the ones that are able to have the political connections and the lobbying power. If it weren't for the heavy-handed, you know, the hand of government in the economy, then there wouldn't be these centralized, you know, mega corporations. You'd see in a free market that a competition, you know, actually, you know, helps out the little guy. The guy who innovates and does the best job would be the guy that wins in the free market. And we see time and time again that that's not the case anymore. People say that, you know, some people say that capitalism is to blame, but we don't have capitalism anymore. We have a mixed economy where the government is in control of a lot of, you know, very important aspects, especially when it comes to the Federal Reserve setting interest rates and that sort of thing. If it were a free market, then we'd all, you know, be much more prosperous and free and happy. Unfortunately, you know, we move far away from that dream of the free market.
Yeah, there goes the little man.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're right. The state is definitely high on taxes and definitely high on regulation. No question about it. Mm-hmm. And it is a shame. I'd like to see, you know, young individuals that have ideas, you know, business ideas and want to do something on their own. And the first thing is, well, no, you've got to go to, you know, the county, or you got to go to the city and you need a permit, or, you know, something of that. I mean, if you have a good or a service that you can provide to someone, and you agree on a price, whatever that is, you've made the agreement, you make a contract, you fulfill it. I don't see where a third party has to be involved. Why the financialization and the centralization? Everything has to go through, you know, the three or four large banks, or everything has to go through. We need to kind of decentralize and definancialize, I guess is the word I'm looking for, and look for some free markets and some ways to. Well, here's an excellent example. 2 years ago, just 2 years ago in California, the medical marijuana. I mean, we had shops that were taxed and regulated, you know, throughout California, and they were doing quite a big. Well, from what I understand, a great business, and the tax revenues were coming into the state. And then a year later, the feds came in and started shutting them down. And, and all of a sudden, the state just was stood by silently, not say anything. and now they've disappeared, or a lot of them, from what I read, have disappeared. And of course, the tax revenue along with it. So I think that business has not disappeared. It's simply gone, what's the word, underground, perhaps?
Yeah, into the black market again.
You know, into that again.
There are still medical marijuana dispensaries, but they're definitely being harassed by the feds. I think it's going to be very interesting what Washington and Colorado have done with legalizing recreational marijuana. I believe there will be a Supreme Court hearing on the whether or not they're going to let them do that. And I think it's unfortunate that we've gotten to this point where there's been so much control for so long over, you know, what people are allowed to put in their bodies, that we've gotten to the point where we're used to not being able to have access to certain medicines. You know, for a very long time in the 1800s, marijuana was used legitimately as a medicine. It was prescribed. A lot of people don't know that. George Washington grew not just hemp, but
hemp for all the rope on the ships.
For the rope on the ships, but not just hemp. He did grow marijuana, most likely for medicinal purposes, and it's excellent in that case. There's a lot of other reasons that I believe that you know, there was William Randolph Hearst, who you know, he's the one who, you know, with yellow journalism and muckraking, and the film Reefer Madness. If you ever heard of that, it really, you know, portrayed it as an evil drug that makes people go crazy and do terrible things and hurt people, and but which of course we see now is not the case. You know,
maybe that was alcohol
more,
they referred to.
Yeah, right. You know, I think you know, alcohol causes far more problems, and yet it's a socially acceptable drug. You know, there's more of a stigma with marijuana, mm-hmm. but there's far fewer health problems associated with it. So I don't see what the problem is, yeah. And I don't think that anybody's trying to force it down anybody's throat. It's your own personal decision, but I don't think it's the government's place to tell you what to put in your own body. Mm-hmm. I think moving back to healthcare. Yeah. That there's, and when it comes to your
industry,
your central healthcare, the kind that you know, takes care of most people, it's so heavily regulated and taxed, and there's so many rules that go along with it, and doctors are so afraid of being sued or taken to court for you know, plethora of things. That it creates this huge cost, and that's why we spend so much more money on healthcare for a system that is just barely squeaking us by. Where you do see innovation in healthcare is things that are relatively free of regulation, such as LASIK eye surgery. You know, the price of that has gone down by far, and you see that, mm-hmm. because it's not a a procedure that has been heavily regulated by the government. You also see a lot of innovation with it when it comes to plastic surgery. It's another thing that hasn't been that heavily regulated by the government. But you don't see innovation in a lot of other areas. It's unfortunate. You also see innovation in the computer industry with Moore's Law. You know, chips are getting smaller and cheaper, and we're getting more computer technology and more things. But because the government stands in the way when it comes to healthcare, with the so-called Affordable Care Act, the Obamacare, is actually making things much less affordable and more expensive. I think that it's going to come to a point where people might have to go elsewhere to get good treatment, which is very unfortunate.
The healthcare industry is a huge, huge complex mess. It really is. But you know, it wasn't that long ago that a fee for service, you know, if you had something that you needed to, felt like you needed to see a doctor, and you made an appointment and you paid cash, or you know, if you didn't have cash, you had three or four chickens and he would accept three or four chickens, you know, and you know, hopefully you got better. But now it's a it's almost like a corporate you know, takeover, along with the pharmaceutical companies again, and then it's going back to the medical marijuana. Right. They don't want to see that, you know. They'll fight against it.
The only way the pharmaceutical companies have been able to keep the other you know, innovation in drugs out is because of the FDA. There are life-saving drugs that have been developed by some pharmaceutical companies, and that if they were allowed to be put out as an experimental drug into the market, that it could really save lives. I personally know a man who contracted AIDS in the 80s, and he ended up going blind because he didn't have access to a life-saving experimental drug that could have saved his sight. Unfortunately, you know, he did go blind, but he eventually got access to this experimental drug, and it saved his life, and he's still with us today. But there are far many people whose have lost their lives because they didn't have access to the right drugs. And this is the thing about it. You know, a lot of people think libertarians are crazy for wanting to legalize all drugs. We just want people to have access to things that are going to be able to save their lives and save the lives of others. And we want addicts, people who have a problem with them, to be able to seek treatment and not to be thrown in jail just because they have an addiction.
Well, I think compared to Reefer Madness on marijuana in the 50s, the media still controls a lot of outlets for drugs, and that's why libertarians get such a bad rap.
Mm-hmm.
This idea that three companies control every single media outlet, except this one, of course, because it's public
thank
government.
Goodness, yeah.
Yeah, it just makes it much harder to get the right information. I mean, it's been 50 years before Washington and Colorado legalized marijuana from 1937 when it got banned. I mean, it takes a long, slow process when the media is involved, but when we decentralize things, like you were saying, innovation comes a lot faster.
Yeah.
Speaking of innovation, and we're a couple of us I know are into firearms. We like to use them responsibly, but Yeah, I mean, we're talking about 3D, you know, printers and bots now, and I think, Vaughn, I wanted to ask you, I think between you and I, we could probably make our own semi-automatic if we wanted to.
Yeah, quite possibly out of your garage with tools you can find at Home Depot, you know, but there's also Defense Distributed, who's working on printing guns out of a computer box that just builds a gun,
mm-hmm.
and it's pretty intricate and impressive, to say
the
least.
So the old school is talking about, you know, regulations on guns and semi-automatics and all these feel-good, you know, ideas or laws that are supposed to make us safer, and when in fact, just like we've seen, you know, for eons, there's always a way around, and there'll always be a way around, and, you know, now we'll have the technology soon and the raw materials to manufacture your own.
Yeah, well, you can prohibit drugs, you can prohibit alcohol, people are still going to use drugs and drink alcohol. You can prohibit guns.
Right. And if they do, you know, if someone does harm, we have laws for that, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. The fact that, you know, you were under the influence or something, maybe that's not the point. Mm-hmm. Maybe the point is personal responsibility.
That's right. I think that when it comes to innovation, you see it in industries that, like I was saying earlier, are not heavily regulated, and that's where these 3D printers are amazing, and how not only are they able to print guns, they're able to print almost anything.
Right.
They're developing ones that will be able to print in different materials like glass and metal, mm-hmm. and
absolutely.
Eventually there will be 3D printers that can print silicon microchips, and then you could have a 3D printer that creates a computer, and then
self-replicating.
Yeah, perhaps. Exactly.
So then my question is, how is that going to interact with CISPA?
Oh,
that's a really good
question, because they're trying to ban 3D printers because it's this file that allows you
to amend it. Well,
that'll be something for the viewer to think about after we close out here.
Yeah,
we don't have all the answers, unfortunately. I don't know how that's going to play out, but I think that there is hope. I think that through the free market and through true capitalism and not crony capitalism, we'll be able to make a better life for everyone. I think that if we recognize that we really need our freedoms, that our freedoms are imperative, that not just, you know, the typical kind of freedom like freedom of speech and freedom of the press, those are important, but economic freedom, mm-hmm. and freedom to have control over your own body and be able to use the kind of treatments for whatever ailments that you mm-hmm. might have, those are the kinds of freedoms that are coming under fire, and the freedom of being able to own guns is definitely under fire. So I think that's just about all the time that we have for this week's episode of Libertarian Counterpoint.
Well, to your point, yes. You know, it's been a great evening.
Thanks
you
again,
young
guys.
Gentlemen,
yeah.
I think are...
Thanks, Vaughn.
I see a great future here.
Thank you.
I do, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks, Steve.
Only point I'd like to add is we can't have political freedom without economic freedom.
That's true.
And I think that's something that both parties sorely miss.
Yeah.
One party focuses on social, one focuses on economic.
Yeah.
We need both.
Or both
will be lost.
Kind of like crony capitalism.
Yeah.
Economics is that website.